So the crack starts on the surface of the material, and as it starts to go down, because this is 100% tetragonal, full strength zirconia, we get the crystals changing from the tetragonal to the monoclinic, clamping down on that crack to keep it from going any deeper. Considering that this has been around for 3 years now, from year 5 to year 8 in this study, this should have been really concerning for another material, but again, the 100% tetragonal zirconia is just kind of chugging along happily. In this module, we're going to tackle material selection for crown and bridge. And this certainly of all the modules has gotten the most complicated over the last, say, 35 years. So when I was in dental school, it was two things. You had your choice basically of PFMs or cast gold. You know, the PFM was invented in 1959 and became the workhorse of the dental industry because it was more aesthetic than what had been the workhorse for the two or three decades or four decades before that, which was cast gold. And till the introduction in 2007 of lithium disilicate, IPS EMAX, and then of course in 2009 with the introduction of BruxZir solid zirconia, these were the first two all ceramic systems that really provided a challenge for the PFM. And so the landscape definitely changed, and we'll take a look at that more specifically. And so now it's gotten more confusing with these different classes that we have to choose from, which are now largely high strength all ceramic materials, or certainly all ceramic materials, not all of them are high strength. So gone are the simple days of just trying to choose between a PFM and a cast gold crown. Things have definitely gotten a little more confusing now. So as we go a little deeper into zirconium, dentists will often say to me, isn't zirconium a metal? And as you look at the periodic table of elements here, I don't know if you've seen this since high school or college, but there's zirconium right underneath titanium. It's in the group 4 transitional metals. And so zirconium is related to titanium in the same family. So yeah, zirconium is in fact a metal. So those are some zirconium rods. They're used to cool things like in nuclear reactors and other things like that. So zirconium, as on the periodic table, is in fact a metal. But this is zirconium oxide, this pile of white powder that looks like an outtake from Scarface here. This is what all dental crowns are made of. So the oxide of zirconium, zirconium oxide, is this polycrystalline material that you see on the right. So it's not a metal. Zirconium is, but the oxide is not. And that's true for a lot of the group 4 metals. Now I want to show you some things about the crystalline structure of zirconia that helps explain why it's as strong as it is and why it's important to kind of know the characteristics of the zirconias that you're using. So this is the monoclinic crystal structure. This normally occurs at room temperature. So that pile of white powder that you saw on the last slide, that is, would typically be this monoclinic crystal structure. And what we do with dental zirconia is we actually add things. We add some dopants to it so that at room temperature, we will have this tetragonal crystal structure that you see here. So the important difference to note between these two crystals, as you look at the monoclinic and the tetragonal, is that the monoclinic looks like it's kind of shifted off axis a little bit. And as a result, it's about 2 to 3% more volume in size, the crystal structure itself, compared to the tetragonal, which is more compact. And usually, like you can see there, you'd have to heat the zirconia oxide over 1170 degrees Celsius to get the material, the crystals in the zirconia oxide, to go into this tetragonal pattern. But by adding things to the zirconia, we can keep dental zirconia oxide at the tetragonal crystalline structure at room temperature. That's very important, and it helps to explain what we were just saying about full strength zirconia as being 100% tetragonal. This is what tetragonal means, is that 100% of the crystals in original BruxZir, for example, are these tetragonal crystals. More on that in a second. Because something important happens when you have 100% tetragonal crystals. So all of these blue crystalline structures that you see here, these are all tetragonal crystals. And now the toughening mechanism, the transformational toughening, takes place when a crack is introduced into the material. This could be from us aggressively doing an occlusal adjustment on the zirconia or recontouring the zirconia. Maybe not, you know, the patient just biting down on it too hard, or maybe hitting a rock in something that they bite on. And a crack will start in the zirconia and you've got this frontal zone where all the energy is taking place as the crack moves its way down into it. And here's what's happened is that you get this wake. The energy actually causes these tetragonal crystals adjacent to the fracture that's going into the material to change to monoclinic crystalline structure. And if you remember from that drawing on the last slide, the monoclinic crystal structure is actually 3% bigger in volume. Remember how it was like shifted on its axis? It looked like you took the tetragonal and squeezed it so it got a little bit bigger. And so what happens is those tetragonal crystals actually switch to the monoclinic. And so those crystals now get 2 to 3% bigger in volume. And when that happens, you can see this little compression that happens, and you can see it compress along that crack. And so really what happens is it stops the crack, it closes the, cramps down on it so it can't go any farther down in the material. It doesn't close it all the way. You can still see that the beginning of the fracture on the surface is there, but it won't go any deeper now because the monoclinic crystals have changed. It's gone from the tetragonal to the monoclinic. They increase in volume and they clamp down on the fracture itself. So this is an SEM from Relic Christensen's ongoing study, which is now at the 8-year mark of original BruxZir, and this is an SEM of original BruxZir crown that's been in the mouth now for 8 years. And if you look on the right, the yellow arrow is pointing to a defect that occurred at year 5. And that's the one I wanna take a closer look at, because when you look at that defect from year 5 and you see how deep that is and how wide that is, that would have been a failure in any other all ceramic material. This is, I mean, we would have never been able to take this SEM because a crack like that and everything, you know, facial to that just shears off, and that is an absolute fracture. But this is a good example of the transformational toughening taking place. So the crack starts on the surface of the material, and as it starts to go down, because this is 100% tetragonal, full strength zirconia, we get the crystals changing from the tetragonal to the monoclinic, clamping down on that crack to keep it from going any deeper. It doesn't do it all the way at the surface, but that's okay, because down where it matters, as it's heading deeper and deeper, it's been closed off and that crack can't go any further. And you see it kind of happening in a couple different areas. So considering that this has been around for 3 years now, from year 5 to year 8 in this study, this should have been really concerning for another material. But again, the 100% tetragonal zirconia is just kind of chugging along happily, even though it's got this defect on the surface, which of course is completely, can't be seen by the naked eye.
Are you enjoying this instructional video? I hope so. If you'd like to receive additional clinical instruction with AGD and ADA approved CE credits, all at no charge, be sure to visit glidewelldental.com/education, where in addition to over 60 on-demand clinical courses, you can also access our weekly webinars along with other valuable content.
Things in ads that feature zirconia oxide.